Well, good morning, church. This morning, I'm getting the opportunity to share with our Heart for the World family in El Paso. And yet, I really wanted to give this last message on this series we've been doing called Powerful, because I really was excited about this message and really believed that God would use this to make a big difference in our lives. And so we're going to look a little bit at Philemon, little book there at verse 6, but we've been talking about what does it mean to be a powerful person. And at the heart of it, we said a powerful person is someone who chooses a victor mindset instead of victim mindset in order to make a difference for God. They're always asking the question, not what can't I do or what's not possible, but they're asking, what can I do in Jesus' name? What is the difference that I can make? What choice and decision that can I make today that's going to move the kingdom of God forward? And we've used some different examples. I mentioned Nick Vujicic, who was born without arms and legs, and he's just my hero. And in his book, he talked about how here he was, but he believed the word of God that said about the blind man. He said that, I believe that this has happened for the glory of God somehow. And he said, Lord, I'm asking for a miracle. I'm asking for my arms and legs to grow out. But he said, if I can't get a miracle, let me become a miracle. And now he travels around the world. And when he shares the gospel with people with different kinds of disabilities, they see God. I mentioned last week the 16-year-old girl named Celine who didn't just go over to India and see that they needed education, but began to say, hey, I bet I could raise money and hire an English teacher. I love the story about the four lepers in the book of 2 Kings. They're sitting on the wall of Jerusalem. They're surrounded by this enemy, and all the people in Jerusalem are starving to death. One of them turns to his friend and he said, why are we just sitting here till we die? Well, his friend said, well, what should we do? He said, well, let's just go on over to the camp of the enemy. We might as well charge. All we can do is die anyway. But even as these lepers began to charge towards the problem, God moved and sent an earthquake and sent a scare, and the people all scattered. You know, it's amazing when you find someone who makes decisions of faith, God starts moving, God starts doing things that are just incredible. I was remembering our ladies group over in the Northeast Church we used to pastor, and there was a part of Northeast called the Devil's Triangle, and it was where the most crime was and the most gangs. And a group of about 30 ladies just decided they were going to attack that neighborhood. They called themselves the Ladies in Pink, and they all wore pink sweatshirts, and they got bags of groceries, and they just started going into this community, knocking on doors, praying for people. I remember the story how one of the gangbangers they came up to, and the guy you expect him to be kind of tough, but all of a sudden he just started crying and he started confessing his sins and asking them to forgive him. But it's just so amazing when you have people who choose to be powerful. People like the Apostle Paul who said, I have not received a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, one of the things that's so important if we're going to live a powerful life is what I call the power of a new identity. One of the things that every person who ever moves in the power of God has in common is that they take responsibility for seeing themselves the way God sees them. They take responsibility for believing that they are who God says they are. They refuse to let other people, they refuse to let the world decide for them how they're going to feel about themselves. They refuse to wear the labels, the rejection. They refuse anything except to believe, I am who God said I am, and I can do what God says I can do. Someone said, it is so true that often the price tag you put on yourself is the price tag the world will eventually put upon you. That so often we can never go higher in our life, because if you feel unworthy and you feel worthless, you're not going to let God use you the way that he could use you. There's going to be a lid on your life. There's going to be something that constantly holds you back. And that's what in the book of Philemon, Paul gives this powerful verse. Let me just read Philemon chapter 1, verse 6. He says, that the communication of your faith may become effectual, or your faith might become activated or powerful by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. He says one of the ways that your faith begins to get powerful, and we talked about faith is the ability to do what God wants you to do with the power he wants you to have. And one of the ways that that's released in you is as you learn to affirm all the good that's in you in Christ Jesus. Instead of just looking at your faults and your weaknesses, you begin to affirm, here's who I am. Here's what I can do. I love to tell the story of the dad who's pushing his toddler around the grocery store, like at Walmart. The toddler's pulling things off the shelves, jumping out of the cart. You know how they do. And the father is mumbling under his own breath, Tommy, you have a spirit of peace. You can do this, Tommy. You can do all things through Christ. It's okay, Tommy. You're a good boy. It's okay, Tommy. You'll overcome. Someone noticed him and came up and said, my goodness, it's so amazing how you speak such encouraging words to your little son, Tommy. He said, are you kidding? His name is George. My name is Tommy. He was speaking to himself who he was. Because at the bottom of everything, who you see yourself to be is what you have the power to become. I like to say it this way. Powerful people live by their position, not by their condition. What do I mean by that? They live by their position, who they are in Christ, not by what they feel around them or by what's happening. We see this in Jesus' life. He stood on who he was. He refused to be brought down. Remember when Jesus was out in the wilderness and he was tempted by Satan? And isn't it interesting? Satan's temptation was what? If you are the Son of God, you know, turn these rocks into bread. Can I just tell you something about Satan? The first place he always attacks you is your identity. If you are a child of God, if you really are a Christian, you see, he doesn't just want to make you fall. He wants to steal from you your identity, because if he can bring your identity down, he'll bring you down. But what's so beautiful is you remember how Jesus responded. He stood in who he was. He said, it is written. In other words, he said, I am the Son of God, not if I am the Son of God. And therefore, I take my authority and I tell you, this is the way it is. People who really have victory in their life, they're not looking at how they feel. Jesus probably didn't feel very good after not eating for 40 days. It didn't look like he was very successful. And yet he knew what his father had said. You are my beloved son, and in you I'm well pleased. And he operated out of that position. I am loved. I want to challenge you that you, if you want to be powerful, let the first thing you do every day is to wake up and remember who you are. And stand in that. This is the key point of a victorious life. C.S. Lewis said this. He said, putting on Christ is not one of many jobs a Christian has to do. It is not a sort of spiritual exercise for the top of the class. It is the whole of Christianity. In other words, you were an old person, but when you became a Christian, praise God, there was a brand new you. You are the righteousness of God. You are a workmanship, a masterpiece created for good works. And learning to put that on will determine the whole course of your spiritual life. Have you noticed in the Bible, every time God called someone to a higher calling or a bigger challenge, the first thing he would do often is to affirm their identity. When Peter first came to Jesus, remember his name was Simon. The name Simon kind of means shifty or unstable. And if anyone would have looked at Peter, that's exactly who they would have said he was. They would have said, hey, insecure, or hey, shifty. But when Jesus looks at him, he says, your name is not Simon anymore. Your name is Peter. You know what that means? Rock or rocky. You are Rocky 1, Rocky 2, Rocky 3, Rocky 4. You are powerful. And then Peter was able to live up to that. The same with Gideon. He was hiding from the Midianites. He was terrified. But when the angel of the Lord appeared to him, he said, Gideon, you mighty man of valor. And Gideon said, who, me? Are you kidding? And God said, Gideon, if you're ever going to be who you're called to be, you need to know who you are seen to be in heaven. In heaven, this is how we see you. Mighty man. That began the basis for him to powerfully rise up. You see, our potential is at stake here. But even also, our relationships are at stake. How we love others. In Mark chapter 12, verse 21, the very familiar verse, it says, you are to love your neighbor as yourself. Have you ever noticed it doesn't say, love your neighbor instead of loving yourself? It says, love your neighbor as an outflow of how you love yourself. It is just as simple as this. The person who sees value in themselves easily communicates value and love to others. Have you noticed people who really don't like themselves, it's hard for them to really build up other people. And yet you find people that really are ready to encourage themselves, the way they encourage themselves just normally overflows to the other people around them. What I've learned, and I think it was James Dobson a number of years ago who said, for example, what makes a real good relationship? For example, a good marriage. And one of the things that James Dobson said about intimacy, what is real intimacy? He said, intimacy is a shared sense of value. It is two people who value themselves, and in that value of themselves also can really value each other. For example, if you're the kind of person who thinks you're better than your spouse, you'll put her down or him down, and that won't make a good marriage. But on the other hand, if you're someone who thinks you're no good, you're a liability, you will have a difficult time receiving love. Have you ever met someone when you tried to compliment them, they couldn't be complimented, you know? You said, you're such a special person. No, I'm not, you know, because their heart would not allow that kind of esteem to come in. But where there is the right esteem, there is a power for intimacy. People who really have the right value of themselves are people who become secure. They're not threatened by other people. They don't have to power up all the time to prove their worth because they know their worth to God. I love the verse in John 13. You remember the story, the disciples and Jesus getting ready for the Last Supper, and there's a big argument going on. Disciples are arguing about who's the greatest. You know, John's saying, well, I'm greater than you, and Peter's saying, no, I'm the guy that is usually the first one to speak out. All of this is going on. And Jesus just takes off his robes and starts washing feet. And there's this interesting verse in John 13, 3. It says, Jesus, knowing that he had come from the Father and was going to the Father, took off his robe and began to serve. Because Jesus just knew he was going to the Father, he had the security to kind of power down, put himself out of the picture, and love on others. Someone said a secure or humble person doesn't think of themselves as less, they just think of themselves less because they are secure in who they are. This same kind of value of ourselves draws people to us. If you really want to have an influence and an impact on people, one of the ways you do that is just by having this confidence that God gives us when we know that we're loved. When perfect love has cast out our fear, there will be an ease about us. There will be a joy about us that makes people want to listen to what we have to say. I've told this story too, but I loved it about my daughter Heidi, who had so many friends in high school. And someone asked one time, how do you make so many friends? What do you do? How do you do this? And Heidi's response was, I never try to make friends. I just know everybody wants to be my friend. You know what she was portraying? She was saying, I know who I am. I'm powerful. And people are drawn to that because it flows out of who we are in God. As I said, it's also no surprise that this is where Satan attacks us the most. Satan continually tries to bring us lies and labels that would keep us from knowing who we are, so that we would exercise the power that we have. I believe with all my heart that I think of especially the young people. This is the most lied to generation in history, the most labeled people. Everywhere you go and social media and everything, people are telling you how you're supposed to look. They're telling you what you're supposed to own or what you're supposed to have. They're telling you, you better belong to this group or you better belong to that group. And behind it all is this sense of you don't measure up. You're not quite good enough. You don't have the right physical look. You know, you don't have the right social look. And what a victim is someone who looks to people or the world to give them their identity. And when you do that, what you receive from the world is a label and a lie. You begin to receive feedback about yourself that begins to mark you as less than what God wants you to be, that begins to mark you as someone who's condemned or unable to really be what God's called you to be. A victor, on the other hand, is someone says, look, I'm not going to let the devil choose what I'm going to believe about myself. I'm not going to let people tell me what I'm going to believe about myself. I'm going to let God tell me what I believe about myself. And I just remember, I've shared this testimony before, but how just as a young person, I allowed a spirit of rejection. I call it an orphan spirit, just through little things. These are kind of stupid things, but I remember as a little boy, I had a great big head and a little body. My body had to grow into my head, and I remember people would make fun of me. They called me Jughead. Well, I became very sensitive about that, and all of a sudden, just as a little boy, I took on myself, I'm not okay, I'm not right, and I began to become shy. I remember also, though my dad was actually starting a business, I was in the fifth grade or something, and I happened to go to a school that had lots of doctors and lawyers, kind of an upscale over in the Coronado area of El Paso. And the teacher was asking everyone, what does your dad do for a living? You know, they're going around the whole class. And at the time, my dad was managing a place that made broom handles, that manufactured these wood products. And for some reason, I just kind of said it stupid, but I said, well, my dad makes broom handles. And all the kids started laughing at me. And I never said anything, but inside, I started to feel, ashamed. You see, the devil will take any opportunity he can to put shame on you. Shame is the belief of a lie that says your value or your worth is based on your performance or how you measure up to others. The moment you start to take shame, you begin to live out of that identity. Worthless, broken, you know, not competent. And again, I tell this is kind of embarrassing, but I just begin to develop this image. So I've told people before, the first time I asked a girl out or something and a little out of junior high, the way I asked her was, there's no way in the world you'd like to go out with me, is there? And she said, absolutely not. I said, thank you. And I hung up. But it was the idea. I was already rejected before I ever even thought. I don't think that I'm unusual. I may be weird, but I'm not unusual. I bet you many of you have had experiences. Maybe it was your failures. Maybe it was a divorce. Maybe it was that you were incarcerated, or maybe one of your kids kind of got off track. Maybe it's that you had some mental struggles with depression, fear, anxiety attacks. Maybe it was unemployment. We could go on and on. But many of us, somewhere in our life, were rejected or were somehow treated badly or failed, and somehow we gave in to taking and putting that on as an identity. Instead of failure being an event, it became an identity. Instead of rejection being an event, it became who we began to see ourselves as. You see, the devil loves us to wear his clothes, and his clothes are clothes of shame and failure and worthlessness. These things carry with us into our Christian life. And until these things are broken, we live far beneath our privileges. So how do we break out of that? The good news is that God has made a way for us to be free from our labels, our lies, from the old beliefs, from the powerlessness of low self-esteem and rejection. In fact, the Bible tells us that he took all of the accusations against us and he nailed it to the cross. And he gave us his very own identity. If anyone is in Christ, guess what? You're a new creation. What defines you is not what you've done. What defines you is what Jesus did for you. Mark Driscoll said it this way. He said, "You are no longer what you've been. You are not what you've done. You are what Jesus did for you." That's who you are. You're not an ex-addict. You're not a nobody. You're not a throwaway. You're not an orphan. You're not a slave. You are a child of God. You are to the Father what Jesus is, because you are in Christ, accepted, beloved, chosen, more than conqueror, the righteousness of God, forgiven, friend of God, adopted son and daughter. Jesus has labeled us. And one of my favorite verses is, you know, people these days really are into tattoos, and I don't really want to preach on tattoos. I just think it's interesting. A lot of times people will put a tattoo that will kind of identify with them as far as something in their past. But I like to tell people, did you know that God has a tattoo? That God has a tattoo? And it's in Isaiah 49, 15 and 16. It says, "Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will never forget you. See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me." You know what the tattoo Jesus has? It was made by nails on a cross. And when he died, he engraved you on the palm of his hands. You are mine. You can never be condemned again because I bore your condemnation. You can never be someone who is without hope because I'll never forget you. God wants us to claim this as the very foundation of our life. How do we do that? Number one, I'm challenging you to make it a priority to live out of your position, not your condition. There is nothing that you will do in your life more important than every day to remember who you are. You know, like going back to Lion King, Simba, remember who you are, you know. I think of an illustration of this. Maybe some of you saw the Bourne Identity, the Bourne movies. And the whole basis of that is here's this man who's had amnesia and he can't remember who he is. And it's a big drama, but the whole thing is based on him being willing to do anything to figure out, who am I? Who am I? You know, and he gets shot at. He goes overboard in a boat because he realized his whole life depended on him knowing who he was. Who am I? The moment you came to Jesus, you became a new person that didn't exist before. Do you know who you are? And I don't mean just knowing it in your head. This is what makes the difference when you know it in your heart. In James chapter 1, verses 22 and 23, he tells of a man who looks at himself in a mirror, and then he walks away and he forgets who he was. In other words, I can imagine maybe he looked in the mirror and he saw a big piece of pie stuck to the side of his mouth or something that he did there. But then he was in a hurry and he went and he never acted on what he saw to clean up his face or whatever. And many of us, we hear the word Sunday after Sunday, or we read the word, but we never internalize and say, no, this is who I am. We never stand in our position as St. Augustine did when he was tempted by a woman who had tempted him before he was a Christian. And she said, Augustine, it's me, it's me. And he looked at her and said, yes, but I'm not me. I'm crucified with Christ. And he walked away. He said, I know who I am. I'm clean before the Lord. I'm holy. I'm a man of God now. I'm a son of God. Part of this means learning to love yourself with God's love for you. Accept God's opinion of you as your opinion of yourself. Can I just tell you what I know about every one of us? Probably 80 to 90% of the things we tell ourselves are lies. If you're like me, you don't even realize how many times, maybe in a day, you'll say things maybe like, oh, that was so stupid, or you dummy, Walker, what's wrong with you, or you're never going to make it, I can't handle it, I'm not going to make it through, or my life stinks, and we don't even realize that we're putting those labels back on us that Jesus took off of us. 1 John 5:16 says, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. It's one thing to know about it, but it's another thing. I am going to think and act as someone who's loved. Another pastor said, do you want to change your identity? Decide that you are going to make the most important opinion about you the opinion of the one whose opinion matters the most. How many know the person's opinion who matters the most in the whole universe is God's? It's not what you think about you, and it's not what your neighbor thinks about you. It's what God. Why not make his opinion the most important opinion? One of the things I'm trying to learn is to have a low opinion of my opinion, because my opinion doesn't matter. And how do we get that when we understand God is absolutely in love with you? He treasures you. He adores you. He doesn't see a single fault in you. Brennan Manning, in his book Furious Longing for God, said, God's love for you is never, never, never based on your performance. It's never conditioned by your moods or elation or depression. The furious love of God knows no shadow of alteration or change. It is reliable, and it is always tender. See, God doesn't love you because you're so cute. He loves you because he is love, and he can't stop himself. And so nothing in the beloved changes his feeling. Henry Cloud said, the heart of Christianity is not about learning to be good. It's about learning to be loved, because it's the hardest thing to learn in life. How do I learn to be loved? How do I learn to just be comfortable in my own skin? How do I learn to wake up happy that I'm me? How do I learn to feel good and think, I would like to be my best friend forever? It's only by internalizing how God loves us. One of the things I like to suggest is that you begin daily to actively allow yourself to act towards yourself the way God wants you to act towards others. All of us understand we're supposed to love people, but some of us never apply that to how we treat ourselves. Let me give you some examples. Do you forgive yourself? I mean, really, 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 really forgive yourself. You know that you have to forgive other people, but when you let yourself down or let others down, do you allow yourself to say, okay, it's over now. It's under the blood. You're forgiven. Go and sin no more. You know, go and be free. Some of you here today need to actualize and forgive yourself. Encourage yourself. I love the verse in 1 Samuel 30, verse 16. It said, David encouraged himself in the Lord. Nobody else would encourage him. See, David was powerful because he did not wait for someone else to validate him. He validated himself in the truth of who God was. I don't know how he did it, but his whole world was falling apart, and yet I could just hear David saying, David, you're going to make it. David, God is for you. Who can be against you? That encouragement towards himself became encouragement to others. Learn to believe in yourself. Part of love is saying, I believe in you. And did you know God believes in you? Because love believes all things, endures all things, hopes all things, and love never fails. I don't think there's anything more powerful than to know deep in your heart, God really believes I can succeed. The creator of the whole universe believes in me. I remember when I was first called to be a leader and a preacher, I remember arguing so much with God. I said, God, I'm no good at this. I can't do this. I thought I could convince God to choose somebody else. And God would never let me off the hook. He finally just said, hey, Dale, I made you. And I remember just so deep, he says, Dale, I made you smart and I made you good. Now get on with it and do what I know you can do. Do you really believe that God believes in you? Do you really believe that God's standing up there and saying, I know you can make this work. I know you can do it. I made you smart and I made you good. Give yourself positive reinforcement. You know, we're so quick to criticize. How many times do you think about your strengths and not just your weaknesses? Did you know it honors God when you appreciate yourself? When when God finished making the world in 6 days, he looked back and he said, wow, that's good. I can almost see God giving God a high five. Awesome, God. Good job. Did you know the Lord would like you to do that? He would like you to say, I like that about me. That was really good. Encourage yourself. I heard about the little boy who was saying, Dad, Dad, I am the best batter in the world. The dad said, oh, yeah, really? He said, yeah, Dad, watch, watch. And he got a baseball and he got a bat. And he throws the ball up and he swings as hard as he can. And he completely misses the ball. Undaunted, he reaches down, picks the ball up again, throws it up, swings as hard as he can, misses the ball completely. He does this 4 times, never even hits the ball. Finally, he looks up at his dad and he says, man, Dad, did you see that awesome pitching? Well, how many of us are willing to see the good that we have and to focus on that? God is pleased when we do that. Quit comparing yourself with others. Many times we accept Satan's lies because we look at other people and say, well, I could never be like them. I'm not very good. Compared to those people, I'm miserable. We say, I should by now, you know, I should be able to pray like them. And when I pray, it sounds like I'm just dribbling out words. When that person prays, woo, and you just start to get down on yourself because you're comparing yourself. But I believe the Bible teaches us that you have been exactly designed to be the person you are created to be, to fulfill the great and amazing calling God has given you to fulfill. And He didn't make you like anybody else. He made you absolutely unique, and your uniqueness and all about it is what He loves about you. Because He made that about you. He made your uniqueness. He made your face. He made your talents. And He loves you. Heard the little boy who his dad was teaching him how to tie his shoe, and the son was struggling and said, "I don't want to do this, Dad." And then the dad said, "Well, don't you want to tie your shoe pretty like me?" You know what he was saying? "Like my shoe's tied pretty?" And the little boy looks up at his dad. He says, "Dad, I don't want to be pretty like you. I want to be pretty like me." And God wants you to be pretty like you, not like someone else. And then finally, liberate yourself from your old labels, from the lies. Challenge every label of your life with the truth of God's word. Make it your decision today. No one but God will define who I am. I will not look to the approval of people to determine how much I will approve myself. I will not look to my performance, how good I did or didn't do, to define me. I won't look to how I feel today. I will not live by my condition, but I will live by my position. I will not be defined by my past, by my failures, by my struggles, by my sins that I've committed. I will be defined by one thing, and that is what Jesus did for me on the cross, where He settled once and for all, "This is who you are. You are my righteousness. You are this valuable. You are valued based upon my very blood. You are valuable based upon the God of the whole universe would rather come and be killed to have you than to stay in heaven without you. That He would lay aside His dignity, His comfort, His peace of mind, that He would be shadowed with rejection, His own people would spit on Him, He would be thrown to hell for 3 days, because you're worth it, because you're that important, you're worth dying for." And if He was to say anything to you today, He would say, "Please, would you take the label that I made for you, and would you wear it? Forgiven, chosen, no longer a slave, no longer an orphan. You are a child of God." Some of you here today need to accept God's acceptance. How do you do that? You let Jesus take your sins by believing He died on the cross for you. You accept His forgiveness. It's a free gift. You don't earn it. You don't deserve it. You just accept it. And you believe it. Once you believe it, you behave it by just living it out in a love relationship with Him. I'm going to ask the worship team, we're going to sing just a beautiful song. You are a child of God. And I'm just praying that as you sing this, you would let the Holy Spirit reveal this to your heart. That it will be like the kiss that turned the frog into a prince. You know, the kiss of adoption. Galatians says, you've not received the spirit of an orphan. You are not an orphan. You are a son. And it would make you alive. And today, afterwards, some of you need prayer. One of the things that we've been praying for is that the Lord will break an orphan spirit over you. If you carry rejection and you carry a definition by your past or how your parents treated or you didn't live up to this expectation, today, believe God's going to break that and you can be free. In Jesus' name, amen.